Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
We're going to look at God's Word, and Father, as we come to this point, thank you for Izzy. Thank you for the gift that you have given him of teaching. But thank you most for your word. Thank you most for your Holy Spirit opening our eyes and our heart to what you would have for us. We thank you this morning, rejoicing in knowing that we will know more in a few minutes than we do now about your love for us. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, guys, we're going to pick up this morning in Romans chapter 6, verse 1, the beginning of Romans, and the end of chapter 5, ending with this idea, what Paul has been building upon, that sin was that thing that brought death into our lives. And it's a thing that, you know, when I was a young person, I didn't think of sin as a bad thing. I just thought it was the fun stuff to do in life. I don't know if any of you ever felt that way. It was just like, the Bible does say that sin is good or appears good for a season. And, you know, in that early part of the sinning, maybe in the early part of sowing, whatever it is, the Bible says whatever you sow, you are going to what? Reap. So maybe in the sowing part, when you're just planting seeds, that sowing means to plant the seeds into the ground. When you're planting seeds into the ground, you might be planting like junk seeds, not good crops, you know, things that's going to make a good crop. Maybe you're putting in you know, seeds that are going to bring, like, I don't know, poisonous plants and stuff that you don't want in your garden. But, you know, when you're planting it, you can make your rows all straight. You can make the little furrow down the middle, make the irrigation, and put the... But if you're planting the wrong seeds, in that first initial part, you might say, but it all looks so good and perfect, and everything is straight, and it's no big problem. What's going to happen when that stuff starts to sprout? And it starts to grow, and then you look and go, wait a minute, this isn't the wheat that I was expecting, or this isn't the corn, or the, you know, whatever it is, the good stuff that you wanted from life. You're not going to receive it because you planted the wrong stuff. And as a young believer, sin was always seemed good until you found out what the sin brought later. You know, that's what maturity, by the way, brings to us as we grow. We begin to look at temptations in a whole different light. You don't see them as just the momentary pleasure that they bring right then, because you know, well, what will happen down the road from this momentary? But what will be the reaping? What will I reap for doing this one thing right now? Is it worth that? And see, we start to learn that the Bible isn't fooling us. When it says the wages of sin is death, whenever you sow to yourself in sin, you're going to reap death down the road. It might be death to a relationship, death to someone that, you know, maybe is a dear friendship will be ruined. Trust will be lost. And it's so hard to gain back that trust. Once it's lost, it's amazing how hard it is for it to be won back, isn't it? And yet, when we sin, we don't always think about that's the outcome that will happen. So here, Paul is saying sin has had a long time to reign and bring death to us. But at the end of chapter 5, the last verse went on to say, but even so, grace now will reign in righteousness to eternal life through our Lord Jesus. Now we have a different thing to reign in our life, and that's the grace of God. Now, the grace of God, over there in the early days, remember, he's writing to the church that's at Rome. Was Rome a big deal back in the day when Paul's writing to this church? Yeah. They were the world-leading power. This is, what do you call, world central, you know. I mean, they dominated at this point. In the days when Jesus visited the earth 2,000 years ago, Rome wasn't just ruling Italy and the areas around that area. They were ruling the entire known world. So Paul's writing to a church that's in a place where there's influence from everywhere. Rome had a lot of people coming and going from all over the world, and the powers to be. Now, if you read if you read secular history, were the Romans all known for being all upright and godly and good people, all moral, right? They were all just wonderful. Great place to raise your kids. Go to Rome, raise your children. And no, it was actually known for being kind of corrupt, polluted. But in the what we call the political circle, so we just had our elections, you know, the politics of that day, you think we have corrupt politics. Just read Josephus and some of the guys that write about those guys over there in Rome. Those guys were, I mean, they were plotting death to the other guy. You forget it. They didn't have, like, political running races. It was like who survived long enough to make it to office. It was, you know, they just put poison in the guy's drink and kill the ones. And this is what Paul was up against. But because of this, this church had a lot of what we would say worldly influences pressing in on it. And, you know, one of the things we find in church history, whenever we see a church where they're in a place where they have to live godly, but they're surrounded by ungodly. It's hard sometimes to let our light shine when the darkness is so dark. And this is where we need the grace of God. This is where, and it's interesting to me because I think about the context. Paul's writing to a church that they're really being pushed by the surrounding culture to join into ungodliness. Don't be different. Conform and be part of the whole Roman power. And so Paul writes in verse 1, he says, "What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace might increase?" Now this is a teaching that, by the way, had begun to somehow, it's a twisted teaching, but it had actually started to take hold in Rome. That, well, listen, guys, God's grace is greater than our sin. And, you know, when we sin, we can ask God for forgiveness and his unmerited favor. He forgives and he washes away our sin. And so it just, if I sin, I don't have to worry if I sin because he'll forgive me. He's so great. So let's just go ahead and sin. Because the more we sin, the more he'll forgive. And that'll show how great he is, right? That's the teaching that was prevalent when Paul's writing to the church at Rome, is that there were teachers teaching, it's okay, sin your guts out, don't worry about it. It's not going to be a problem. God's grace will be poured out even more, it'll be shown how gracious he is, and that'll just make him look better. We'll be worse, he'll be better. No. Paul gets wind of this, and he writes Romans 6 in a very clear way. He says, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue to sin that grace might increase?" Yes, we've been introduced to this wonderful life that we get to now walk in that is, it is governed by God's grace. But we saw that it said at the last line of chapter 5, that even so grace would reign through what? Through us sinning? No, through righteousness. Through us, righteousness means being in right standing with God. Us doing what is right. By the way, righteousness is, the Bible says there's righteousness of man, which ends in death, because every man does what he seems to be right to him. But there's a righteousness, it says, that is the righteousness of God. What is right in God's sight? That's true righteousness, by the way. The only righteousness that counts in the eternal scale is that you do what is right, not in the sight of man, but you do what's right in his sight. And he says, we are given grace so that we could walk in this righteousness that God has made available. We could be right with him. Now, this righteousness that we have will lead us to eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now, shall we just continue to sin? What was the answer? May it never be. God, this is so strong, by the way, in the Greek. It doesn't translate well to the English, you know, because some translators say, may it never be. The King James Bible I first read taught God forbid. Now, that's a pretty good translation. Because if God forbids something, he said, no, I forbid it. What's it mean? It means no, right? I mean, I know the kids today, they think if you say no, it means just wheedle them a little longer. Can I have this? No. Please, can I have it? No. Please, 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 please. Oh, quit bothering me. Oh, they're starting to bend. You know, no to them just means temporary. It's just a temporary condition of, you know, just a little more wheedling and I'll get my way. A little more annoying, just a little more begging, a little bit more, whatever I have to do to get my... But see, when God says, I say no, I forbid it, what's that mean? Just ask a little more? Can I just please, please, please? No, it means no. I know this isn't very popular to preach, that no actually means no. You know, Jesus said, when it comes to making a vow, he said, don't vow. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. And anything beside that, he says, evil. If somebody says, you know, oh, well, yes, my yes is maybe, or my no is I'll think about it, or no, just be a person of your word. You don't need to vow. You know what I mean? When some people say, I swear to God, I'm telling you the truth. I swear. When they do that, what does it make you think about the rest of the time when they're talking to you? If you got to swear to God that this time you're really telling the truth, how do I know you're telling the truth the rest of the time? See, the Bible teaches us to, Jesus himself said, just let your yes be yes. And let your no be no. Be a person of your word. You know, I grew up with a grandfather. If he said yes, it was yes. If he said no, it didn't matter how much you tried to ask over and over. No meant no. Now, I know that that's not popular in our culture to do, but I think it's a great disservice that we don't do that so that the children learn no is actually no. There might be reasons. And by the way, do we have to have the reason why no is no? If the answer is no, do you really need to know why? I know that we got a whole generation that feels entitled. They must know why. I grew up in the generation where why did not count. It did not matter, and they don't have to explain.
We don't want justice, we want silence.
Just, yeah. That's what I heard Connie said, her folks said, we don't want justice, we just want silence. That's it. How many of you had a similar upbringing, yeah? See, the reality is, we were taught no is no. And we were not entitled to a reason for no. We were just taught it's no. Live with it. Now, is God allowed to say no? Is he allowed to say, I forbid, don't do that? See, what Paul is saying to this church is, they had this mindset of, well, I'll just sin a little extra. It's just going to let God show off his grace. You know, he'll seem like a more gracious guy because I'm sinning and he's forgiving. And Paul says, that's wrong. That's a no. That's a big no. That's a no, 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 God forbid, no. You don't get to just say, I'll continue to sin so God will get to show off more grace. This whole sin thing is pretty serious with God. He doesn't want us to sin for a reason. Verse 2, may it never be, God forbid. How shall we who died to sin still live in it? Or do you not know? And this is something that, how many of you have been baptized before I read you the rest of this verse? Into Christ. I'm just curious. Not into a church. I mean, you just joined yourself to Christ like the Bible teaches. We're going to learn about that today if you haven't already know about it. But baptism, I have so many people ask me, what's a Bible teach about baptism? You know, like they want to know what's the source, say. And that's a good question, by the way. Because if they really know what the biblical teaching about baptism is, they can find out the secret of how to get free from sins that have plagued them. Sins that have got a hook in their, it's a snare, a bond, a fetter. It's just grabbed hold of you, and you're trying to break free, and you can't, and you struggle. If you have that problem, you're going to love today's study because it gives the answer of how to be freed from sin. How do you get free? What if you have some sin that just seems like it's got this power over you? And no matter how hard you try, you can't seem to break that power that has. Anyone ever felt like that in certain ways? What sin has a power that it just keeps like calling to you, come back, do it again, let's do that again. I'm the only one, right? Has that ever experienced, right? No. Sin doesn't matter what particular sin it is. It seems like universally it has this power to just try to keep pulling us back into it. And the Bible teaches how to be free from that power. How do you break that power? Do you pray? Do you, what do you do? Well, the answer is found right here in Romans 6. He tells us this, and it's such a beautiful truth. But by the way, this is the truth that if you really want, anyone here would like to, or maybe you have a friend that needs to be freed from some power of sin in their lives. If you know somebody that's struggling with this, please tell them this truth, what I'm going to tell you right here in this book. And if you can't remember, just remember, it's Romans 6, and you'll find it right here. It's found in what Jesus did for us, and he invites us to join him in this power. It's his power, by the way, that's going to help you get through this. He says here, do you not know that those of us that have been baptized into Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. You say, well, what's the big deal about that? Remember, baptism is a symbolic, joining of yourself to Christ. But you join him in death. You know, when we take someone and we put them in the waters of baptism, we lay them down in those waters, we're symbolically burying them. It's a grave. We're saying, just as Christ was laid and put to rest in the tomb, remember? Then what happened 3 days later? He rose. We're going to bury you in the waters of baptism to join you to Christ. Now, we won't hold you down for 3 days because that would be bad. But when we pull you up, we're saying now you join him in his resurrection. You get to be joined to Jesus. Now, this is really important if you want to get free from sin. Because it says, do you not know, those of us that have been baptized into his death, that we when you got baptized, that's what you were baptized into, Christ's death. Therefore, remember, Paul again, when there's a therefore, what is it? What? Therefore. Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. This whole thing is about having newness of life. If you want to have newness of life, you're going to really, you got to take to heart what Paul says here. You just have to be baptized and joined to Jesus. Because when you are, it says, if we become, verse 5, for if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, well then certainly we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that the old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin. For he who has died is freed from sin. Now, I've taught this over and over. Every time we do baptisms, I've revisited this. But this is so powerful of a truth. And so many believers, even older believers, they forget the power that comes with this truth. Now, remember, in the scripture, are we to turn off our brain to do this whole Christian experience? Don't use your brain. Just all emotional. It's a matter of the heart. You should feel good about this. No, not. That's not what the Bible teaches us. We went over that last week. You love the Lord with all your heart, with all your what? Mind, your soul, and your strength. The whole of your being. I need you to use your mind here today, because Paul's actually going to use a word in the Greek in just a couple paragraphs from now in this chapter, where he's going to say, even so, consider. The word for consider from the Greek, it's a word to think through, to actually come to know by mental thought process. You have to actually think this one through. When you think through that you got baptized and you joined yourself to Jesus in the likeness of his death when you were baptized, he says, you now have joined yourself to him also in his resurrection. And because of these things, he says, you need to consider something. We'll see what you consider in just a minute. Because when he died, well, what's it go on to say? It says, if we have died with him, it says, we believe also we shall live with him. Verse 9 says, knowing this, that Christ, having been raised from the dead, is never to die again. Death is no longer master over him. Will Christ ever die again? No. He did it once. For the death he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. Now, even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God. This is where the power of overcoming sin comes into play. When we consider with our mind, hey, I join myself to Jesus. And Jesus died to sin. Once and for all, sin has no master over you. By the way, once you're dead, I don't care what sin has been wooing you or calling to you for your whole life. Maybe you struggle with different areas. It could be drugs, alcohol, whatever it is, sex, any area of sin, pick whatever it is, it doesn't matter. As soon as you're dead, how much call does that sin have? How much power will it have over you when you're dead? You can bet on a chain smoker. You're like, you don't understand, Pastor. I just can't quit. The nicotine has a really big hook in me. When you're dead, and I'm there doing your funeral, if I get someone, could you light up a cigarette and just give them a cigarette? They're laying in the casket. You know, he always smoked all day long. Would you just get? They look at me. If I said that to someone, really, come on. Go ahead. Pour him a drink. He was an avid alcoholic. Just give him a. Go pour him something to drink, you know. He's laying there in the casket. Once you're dead, are you going to partake of these things? No, because you're freed. Sin will have no power over you once you have died. You're done. It's all over. Power broken. The power of sin has no power when you consider that you, now this is where we have to use our mind. We have to consider that we are dead with Christ. Dead to sin. See, for sin to have no power over you, all you have to do is remember, I died to that. My old nature, I died. I got it buried. It's been buried, and now what you see living before you is a man who has been brought up out of the waters of baptism as a new creature in Christ. The old things, it says, have passed away. And the things what God wants to do in my life, these are things that he does in the Spirit to help me walk in newness of life. This is what it's about, right? Newness of life. Anyone here want newness of life? Forget the old life. But, you know, I never have to hard sell this. There's so many people sick and tired of the oldness of their life. Tired of the problems that they had, the sin that they wrestled with, trying to break free from it. And they just like, I just wish there was some way to quit it. And I'm like, there is. Get baptized. Get baptized into not some church denomination or non-denomination. It doesn't matter what banner. Get baptized into Christ. Join yourself to Jesus. Because when you join yourself to him, he's the one that has the power over sin and death. He's the one who overcame it and was resurrected, and he will take care of you. But you have to stay joined to him. When you consider that you're now that I've died to sin, I can actually live. I can be alive to God. As a new creature in Christ, I can be freed from sin. And there's so many people going, I wish I'd just be free. I wish I could be free. It's not a freedom that you just be free to nothingness. It's a freedom to be now alive to God, to walk in newness of life, to have a new life. And the only way to experience is, well, you have to use your brain. You have to look at that verse there, verse 11. Even so, consider yourself to be dead to sin. Now, when sin appears as a temptation to you, do you use your mind and say, hey, wait a minute, no power, I'm dead to that. I consider myself to be dead. Dead to sin, but alive to God. If you do this, by the way, it works really good. And I've shared with you the example of how I learned this from my early childhood days when I went to a funeral back east, back in Detroit, Michigan, Utica, where my family is from. One of my uncles had died. The one who was this is the Italian side of my family, very heavy, chain smoking, drinking all the time. The one that had a real short temper. We were taught as children, don't. When you go by Tzio, that's uncle. You children are meant to be seen and not heard. Yeah, not even seen when it was with him. Just stay away from him. He had a short. He did not like children. And he was just crude, smoked, drank all the time. And I've shared this before, but it's really to bring this home. See, when I have to consider, I need to use my mind, think, okay, I'm dead to sin. What's that like? And I remember when I was young, they called it awake. I don't know why they call it awake. He's not awake. He's dead. But they called it awake, and they put the casket in the living room. It's open for like 3-5 days straight. He's laying there. And in Italian culture, when there's a funeral, there's an excuse to eat. So each different parts of the family, they take turns bringing, you know, cassadedi and ravioli and all the homemade pastas and tzatzita, you know, homemade sausages and stuff. And every time a new dish, the lasagna gets there, everyone leaves the living room and goes to the kitchen. And they eat that whole course, you know, and they wallow in the, oh, he was such a good man. I was thinking, how come he's so good now that he's dead? Because he wasn't very good when he was alive. But they kept, and they were doing that. And then everyone left the living room, and I was alone. I was like about 10 years old. I crawled up on the side of the casket because I had this curiosity. What's a dead person feel like? You know, like what? I just want to see what he looks like, you know. And when, you know, they just had lifted me up and let me peek, but then put me back down. And he was there with the rosary folded in his hands folded. And he looked so like he was praying. I was thinking, I've never seen him do this. I didn't even know he had a rosary. I mean, I was a raised Italian, Roman Catholic boy. We had rosaries, but I'd never seen him. This is the only time. Wow, where'd you get that? And he's laying there, so peaceful. And I've shared this before, but you know, for my younger ones here, let me tell you, do you know what happens when you poke a dead person? Like, I poked him. And you know what's really weird? This is going to sound maybe a little bit too graphic, but he was cold. It was like a popsicle. You know, his skin, it was cold and it was like hard. I was expecting, you know, like when you push how it gives a little. You pushed on him, it was like a rock. The body was not right. I mean, it was like bink, bink, bink. And I poked him. And he had a bad temper. And you know what he did when I poked him when he was dead? Nothing. You know why? Because he's dead. When you're dead, even your bad temper, you're freed from. And God used this. He used this very life experience to teach me this truth, what it says in the Bible. When you are dead, you're now freed. You don't have to worry about sin anymore. It doesn't have any power. What if I would have got a cigarette for him or poured a drink? Here's your alcohol, Uncle. Here you go. He wouldn't have drank it. He wouldn't have smoked. He was instantly cured of all of his chain smoking. This is the uncle that had the stories, what I would hear about him, because he would insist on smoking until the last breath before he fell asleep. And the problem was he would fall asleep sometimes with the cigarette in his hand, and he had burnt through the covers and almost burnt down the house a few times with my aunt in the bed next to him. It was her that jumped up and put the fire out. And then we keep telling him, you got to quit smoking in bed. And he wouldn't even get his feet out of the bed. First, he had to put a cigarette to his lips before he could get the, you know, body to move enough to get up, to get out. And then he smoked until he went. And there was never a time the cigarette went from down. I don't know if you've ever seen someone who smokes like this. They smoke all the way to the bottom of the cigarette. And then they take another cigarette and they touch it to this one. And they light they take the new one, put it in, and grab a little speck of cigarette left. He didn't have one with filters, sorry. This is, you know, he'd pull it, little pinch of it, put it on the end. And light the next one. And he went like that all. The only time he paused was to eat. Didn't pause for the alcohol. He'd just drink and smoke and drink and just alternate. This is why we call chain smoker, chain drinker, not nice guy. But the moment he died, and this is what I want you to picture in your mind. When he died, was he freed from that? Yeah. Now see, this is what I want to teach you today, is available to us as Christians now. That we can use our mind to realize in baptism, I died to my fleshly desires because I buried them with Christ. Symbolically, that grave was the place where I buried the old man. And there's power in this, by the way. When you realize that you joined Christ in the likeness of his death, now comes the part where you can consider with your mind you are also joined with him in the likeness of his what? His resurrection. And this is how we can walk in newness of life, when we realize I'm no longer bound by that. You know, when the sin comes and presents itself to me, I go, I'm dead to that. I died to that sin. I'm not dead to God. I'm dead to sin. This is what grace is all about. Not so we continue to sin, but that we'd actually be able to walk freed from it. The grace of God actually lets you be free from sin. You don't have to do it. You know, before I was a Christian, I never woke up and said, I wonder if I'm going to sin today. I woke up going, I wonder which ones and how many times. And, you know, I would plan my sin. I don't know, none of you probably did this, right? You never planned any sin. Never got up thinking, I'm going to go do this because that sounds good. Or I'm going to do that. Oh, yeah, and maybe that'll lead to this, and then I'll do that. And man, I wasn't trying to not sin. I was trying to see how much sin could I fit in one day's time. Not knowing that was going to bring death to me. And God goes, I don't want you to have the death. I want you to have what life was really meant to be, freed from sin. And I couldn't even fathom that. What? Life freed from? How do you get freed from sin? Doesn't everybody just do it? It's like natural, right? I mean, yes, it's natural to your old nature. That's why it's called your old nature. Natural to that. But I buried my old nature. So I can now walk as a new creature in Christ. Resurrected into newness of life. And that's what we need. We need Christians to walk in this. How many of you met Christians that are still walking in sin, even though they should be letting it go? I mean, some of us are acutely aware because it's the ones we're close to. We're like, dude, you got to stop that. And you know, I was asked by some of the younger adults, well, don't they see it? Don't they see that that's hurting them? When you're in sin, do you see? Doesn't sin blind us to the reality of what it's doing? I mean, sometimes we do the stupidest things in sin. We're blind. And we forget that we could be freed. We could actually walk where that sin has no power over us if we just used our mind to think, I died. Well, I've shared this so many times, I know it's boring some of you, but I want you to remember this. When it comes to sin and it appears to you, a temptation comes up. I call this assuming the position. My uncle was in the tomb like this, right? Rosary in his hand. And he looked so peaceful. Never saw him look this peaceful. But he was dead. And with my mind, I have to consider me doing this. I am now, when sin comes my way, I call this assuming the position. Get my imaginary rosary. Some of you are going to hate me for saying this, but it helps me picture that I have died to sin. Sin comes along and I'm like, assume the position. And it doesn't matter if the sin is up in my face. Now, I came from a background where I fought a lot, did martial arts, got into fights, it's not good to do. Just once you fight one guy, another guy wants to, you know, if you win on that one, someone else is going to say, well, let's see if you're tougher than me, you know, and there's always another guy. Yep. And they get up in your face and start to try to pick a fight. And, you know, since I've been a Christian, it seems like they haven't gone away. In fact, some of them greet me when I get to church to set up the church here. And I find myself on a weekly basis going, assume the position. I am dead to sin. I cannot beat this guy up. This is not right. Jesus wouldn't do this. Okay, I am dead to sin. And then, and they could be right here, and sometimes they are, and I'm just going, I'm dead to sin. I'm not going to respond in the way of my flesh. Now I can respond, and this is where the power comes in. I've considered myself dead to sin, but alive to God. And now I can say, what do you want me to do about this jerk who I'd like to knuckle print? But I'm not going to, because I died to that. And do you know how much better it is when you live life not after the ways of sin, and you can actually do this? God, what do you want me? It is like whole new things have opened up in my life just from this one truth that I consider I died to sin and I'm now alive to God. I don't have to walk in the old ways of life. I can walk in newness of life. But see, some of you are struggling with, you want to do the new life, but you haven't broke that power of the sin. You haven't found out that thing, that truth that literally makes sin not have any power. And it comes to you as a choice. I can't make you do it. If I could, I'd just mandate it. You're all commanded. We're going to end the sermon now. Go in peace and sin no more. And let any sin, don't entertain it. As soon as it shows up, just say, I'm dead. Assume the position. Died to that. Alive to God. If I could get you all to do that with me for just this week, how bright do you think we'd shine as believers in this community? Would it work? Would it have any impact? This just a small group right here. If all of us would say, we've died to sin, so we can now live to God. Do you think he'd have anything for us in newness of life? In the plan for our lives? Would he have a good plan? It certainly wouldn't be the stuff of sin. It would be the stuff of newness of life. And when people tell me, yeah, Pastor, I want stuff to happen for me like it happens for you. You know, like that was a miracle. That guy was up in your face and you didn't even do nothing and you didn't punch him back and you didn't. And I'm like, you don't understand. I had to go assume the position. Maybe I didn't do this outside. If I should ever do this in front of you and you're this close, you should back away because that's not good. I'm only human, you know. But if I'm doing this, you are pushing the button. You need to walk away. But I have learned to assume this position in my mind when some people get up in my face. And it's the same, and inwardly, it just as I'm in there doing this, dead, I'm dead, I'm dead, I'm dead, I'm not gonna, you have no power, you're a jerk, I'm dead to you. Now I'm alive to God. What do you want me to do? And God goes, love them. Oh, man. Jesus said, you'll know you're my disciple in that you have love for one another. It's love that really counts. But I can't love the right way sometimes when I'm trapped by sin's snares. So I need to be free. And this sermon is to help you learn what the Bible teaches on how to be free. How to be free from sin. Consider you died to it. If you haven't been baptized into Christ, I want to encourage you. You come up and tell me. And we'll make an arrangement. We'll do a baptism. Right? We got the baptismal font right there behind me, the ocean. And we'll baptize you into Jesus. Not amazing grace, into Christ, okay? So that you too can experience this power. There's a great power. And so many believers, they go, well, I was baptized as an infant. So was I in the Catholic Church. They sprinkle some water on me. Did I know that I was considering myself dying to sin and joining myself to Christ in his resurrection when they baptized me? No. How old was Jesus when he was baptized? 30. He was taken to the temple and dedicated as a child. By the way, I think a lot of the ceremonies that are done in some of the churches today are more along the idea of what the Jewish faith taught as baby dedication. But when you come to the age where you now have to make a decision for your own walk in this life, you need to decide whether you want to be joined to Jesus or not. And it's not something your parents did for you, something you got to personally do yourself. Because this is when the power comes to you on a personal level to help you be freed from sin and be able to walk in newness of life. And I want all of you to experience it. If you haven't, it is. I'm even blown away when God helps me pull off that, you know, not punching the guy in the face who deserves it, you know. And instead going, it's okay, you must be having a hard day. What? How can I pray for you? I can't even believe the words came out of my mouth. I'm praying for this jerk. And I'm not punching him. Wow. When someone says, how do I know there's a God? Let me tell you, there's a God. If I did that, there has to be a God. I'm just telling you, I was not wired to just go, oh, let me pray for you. Poor brother, having a rough day, aren't you? You're all up in my face trying to pick a fight. I used to be the guy who goes, you want to fight? Oh, good to see you. Before he could even move, I liked it. I came from a rough upbringing. That was fun. But there's a God that said, that doesn't bring any life. All that does is bring death. And I look back with hindsight and think, how many friends do I have from my high school days? The days when I was fighting all the time. How many of those guys do I hang out with? None. Man, I blew it. I just didn't know it. Learn from my mistake if you can. That's not the way to live. The way to live is to walk away from that and learn to learn what God would have you do. Learn his love. Because that doesn't bring anything. It just brings death. And God wants you to have life. Newness of life. Well, next week, read ahead. The rest of this chapter, Paul's going to do one of those, therefore. Now that you know we died with Christ and we're raised, therefore, what's coming up is really, this is where the foundation of our faith gets really strengthened. We're starting to build walls now on the building of our faith. We're going to put up some of the most strongest, soundest things for a Christian to build that spiritual house, that faith that they need, coming up in the next few chapters of Romans. And guys, it is powerful. When you get this as your foundation, if you don't want to accept this as I'm just trying to explain, this is the foundational stuff right here of our faith. Once you get this established, it's like pouring up a concrete slab. Once it's done, you can build the house. We can build on this very solid things for our faith that will let us continue on in a really, it makes our faith have substance that stands the storms of life. And we have so many people, they don't get this foundation. The storm comes and there's no foundation. What happens to the house? Swept away. It falls. And God doesn't want that for you. So this is all I got for you this morning. Next week we'll pick up here, okay? Would you join me? Let's pray. Father, thanks so much for these truths, what you gave to Paul the Apostle, that you let this man to express these words in a way, Lord, to me, it just helps my faith. And I pray it would help all who hear this, Lord, the ones here, the ones that will listen later on the radio or the internet. We just pray that this word would go out in a way that would help people really, truly come to experience that freedom from sin that creeps into our lives. Lord, free us all. Let us walk in that newness of life you have. And we pray that in Jesus Christ's name. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing a closing song and let you go in the strength of the Lord to have a great week in him.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.